Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Two Princes of Summer by Nissa Leader. Narrated by Jesse Vilinsky. Chapter 1. Graves had always freaked Scarlett out. Dead bodies trapped in boxes for all eternity and buried 6 feet under the ground? No, thank you. If Scarlett had any choice, she would be far away from the Garden of the Dead. But her mom now rested there in a cherrywood casket. It was mostly her sister Ashley's decision, but when Ashley asked Scarlett if she liked it, Scarlett nodded. How could she possibly like something that would hold her mother's dead body for the rest of eternity? But the red hue of the wood reminded Scarlett of her mother's hair. So as far as caskets went, it worked. The sun hid behind the gray clouds as Scarlett neared the edge of the hill, overlooking the cemetery below. Everything was still. Not even a bird chirped. Aside from Scarlett and her sister, the cemetery was void of people. At least anyone living. Many of the headstones scattered about had bouquets on them. Some new, some withered. Others were bare. Scarlett should keep walking. One foot in front of the other. Simple, usually. But her legs felt like cement blocks as she peered down at the sea of graves. Ashley was already halfway down the slope without even a look back. She walked straight to their mom, as she always did. Scarlett plopped crisscross on the ground as she watched Ashley like some stalker, too afraid to get near. The ground chilled Scarlett's bare legs, but she didn't mind. So much for acting like an adult. Scarlett turned 18 1 month before her mom's death. They'd celebrated together by buying $100 worth of scratch tickets, only $15 of which they recouped, while filling their stomachs on pizza and candy. Her mom seemed normal that day. Scarlett had made it through childhood seemingly unscathed. Sure, her life was complicated at times, but that moment, as she morphed from kid to adult with the one person she loved most, was perfect. Optimism swam through Scarlett, but her high didn't last long, and the fall crushed her from the inside out. She rolled the flower stem in her hand. A petal fell to the ground between her legs. Great. She ruined it. Now, if she found the courage to keep going, she'd have nothing to leave. Then again, it had been 6 months since they buried her mom, and she still hadn't found the strength to visit. She doubted today would be any different. Scarlett had always wished for more from life. More excitement. More surprises. More something. She craved new adventure. So much so, she never appreciated what she had. Now her mom was gone, and despite her mom's fits and outbursts, all Scarlett wanted was to have her back. The cool breeze from the storm rolling into town caused goosebumps to rise on Scarlett's skin. She inhaled the spicy smell of the evergreen trees around her. So much death in one place was depressing. A sadness lingered in the air where loved ones grieved the ones they'd lost. Scarlett had spent so much of her life embarrassed by her mother, which to some was just a normal part of life. But unlike her friends who wished their mothers wore different clothes or drove different cars, Scarlett's mother spoke to people who weren't there. Hallucinations plagued her. And though Scarlett seemed normal to everyone else, she sometimes wondered if she too was different somehow. An insecure teenage girl. Shocker. It wasn't her hair or her clothes that made her feel out of place, though. Something else sent an off feeling through Scarlett. Something she couldn't quite put a finger on. She fit in well enough with her classmates. She was liked by most, guys especially. The attention from them made her buzz inside. Sometimes too much. The more they wanted her, the more energized she felt, as if she could absorb the lust radiating from them. A shrink would probably say she had daddy issues or something. Well, lack of daddy issues, since she'd never met her father and knew absolutely nothing about him. Now she didn't even have a mother. With only silence to listen to, she lost herself in memories. Her mother's body sprawled on the ground with limbs in unnatural positions, blood pooled at her sides. Nausea hit Scarlett. She tried to think of anything else, but the memory consumed her as it had so many times. As hard as she tried, she couldn't forget the image. Her mother's upturned wrists revealed a vertical slit on each arm. Suicide. An aura of sorrow, anger, and guilt always surrounded graveyards, an emotional feast for Cade. He had spent the weekend practicing his battle skills, and now his magic ran low. His mother discouraged him leaving Faerie, the Fae realm, so often. He wasn't as protected outside the summer court, but Cade found human emotion the most fulfilling. Most humans in his realm were servants who had exchanged their freedom for the kind of release only the Fae could offer, their emotions already numbed by someone else. So from time to time, Cade came to the mortal world to find untouched rage, sorrow, elation, and any other strong feelings to refuel. A young woman sat along one of the newer graves, her strawberry blonde curls swaying in the breeze. The wind carried the warm scent of her freshly shampooed hair. He'd seen her before, always placing a single rose onto the earth. He'd fed from her emotion, but it didn't satisfy him. She had sadness, sure, but nothing more than a small first course. Likely one of those optimistic types who saw the good in everything, even death. What good there was in dying, Cade didn't know. The Fae could die, but they didn't suffer from disease or old age as often or as soon as humans did. Usually there were others visiting the buried bodies, but today there was no one else. Perhaps the dark gray clouds rolling into town scared the humans away. Cade didn't understand why humans spent so much of their time and their feelings on the dead. But grief was a strong emotion and an easy source of replenishment. The girl gently set a yellow rose down on the ground in front of the headstone. Cade was about to give up and try a bar instead. Alcohol stimulated emotion, and people could be found there, even in the middle of the day, drinking away their problems, as if puking somehow purged their sorrows. As he scanned the graveyard one last time, he noticed movement on top of the hill above. Another young woman sat there. She peered down the hill, still. Within a blink of the eye, Cade evanesced himself to the girl. Even though he wore his invisible glamour, he kept his distance and hid behind a tree, its branches grazing his skin. The girl shared a resemblance to the other. Both had light blue eyes and freckles sprinkled across their noses. But this girl's hair was a dark brown, the opposite of the light tone of the other. And unlike the other girl, a surge of emotion surrounded her. Cade inhaled slowly, allowing his aura to absorb her feelings. Sadness, fear, and guilt mixed. This girl was avoiding something. Cade had never tasted such intense turmoil. It hit her quickly, the hole in her soul. Like a chipped windshield, once cracked, the pain spread and flooded Scarlett. She looked down and, in the distance, saw Ashley lay down today's rose. She should be there too, but she was weak. How was she supposed to move on if she couldn't even visit her mom's grave? The pain swelled inside her until she was ready to burst. Something else hit her. A presence of some sort, as if she were being watched. The emptiness inside her felt almost plugged. Suddenly, she didn't feel so sad, so broken. Scarlett glanced around. She saw no one else in the opening of trees where she waited. If she believed in ghosts, she might have thought her mother had visited her. But she didn't. She didn't know what to believe anymore. Ashley thought their mother had escaped her worldly pain and now spent her days on streets of gold. Scarlett wanted to believe her mother had finally found her paradise. No matter where her mother resided now, Scarlett had to believe she wasn't in pain. Wherever she was gone. Scarlett couldn't ask her for advice, couldn't laugh with her until they cried. Her mom wouldn't be there to watch her walk down the aisle. She couldn't hold Scarlett's future children. It was unfair and stupid and, most of all, it just plain sucked. As the pain crept back in, the pressure in her chest flared. Before she burst into tears as she had every day since her mother died, a calmness rushed through her. Nothingness replaced the knife that pierced her heart. Something was wrong. The grief Scarlett should feel had vanished. She was numb. Chapter 2. Scarlett was 5 when everything changed. She and Ashley were playing with dolls in Scarlett's room when they heard their mom scream. Ashley hid under the bed. Scarlett, the brave soul she was, rushed to the living room. Her mom shouted at someone to leave her alone. She gripped her ears, eyes clamped shut. No one else was there. Fear coursed through Scarlett. Would her mom be okay? What if she wasn't? The panic swam through Scarlett's veins like a raft down furious rapids, destined to crash. Her mind repressed the next few hours, gone from her memory like a ship lost at sea. Eventually, Scarlett's mom calmed down and told the girls not to worry. It was just a freak accident. Things were fine. But the voices kept coming, and Scarlett would often hear her mom talking to someone who wasn't there. Her once vibrant and happy mom turned lethargic and apathetic. That was when Scarlett's love for the piano began. She'd sit at its bench for hours at a time, pressing down the keys randomly as she made up her own songs. It didn't matter how it sounded, as long as it blocked out the noise of her mother talking to nothing and kept Scarlett from worrying about what would happen if the voices didn't stop. When Scarlett's grandma came to visit, she noticed the change in her daughter, and after a weekend of begging, Scarlett's mom agreed to see a doctor. Schizophrenia, the doctor said, which, with medication, could be managed. And at first, things got better, until Scarlett's mom said the pills made her feel funny and she didn't need them. The cycle continued over and over, on the pills, off the pills. Until Scarlett accepted her life for what it was. Scarlett and Ashley walked home silently. The cemetery was about a mile from their house, both convenient and creepy. Rain drizzled as they turned into their neighborhood, coating everything with a fine layer of dampness. Scarlett might have been worried about its effect on her hair, if she cared about things like that anymore. Right after their mom had died, the sisters hugged each other and cried. Scarlett had never felt as close to Ashley as she had in that moment. Maybe it would be their chance to be loving sisters, Scarlett had thought. The kind who believed each other when no one else did. She wanted a sister who had her back. Any hopes Scarlett harbored had disappeared after the funeral. Since then, Ashley barely spoke to her. They ate their meals together with nothing more than pass the salt from Ashley's lips. Not even a please. What did I do? Scarlett blurted as they stepped onto their porch, its old wood creaking beneath their feet. Huh? Ashley asked, taking her hand off the doorknob. You barely even look at me anymore. Ashley rolled down the sleeves of her yellow cardigan. It's just hard, okay? What's hard? Scarlett stood with her arms dangling at her sides. Losing Mom. It's hard for me too, Ash. I'm sure it is. Ashley rolled her eyes as obviously as possible. What's that supposed to mean? You always complained about how hard your life was. I'm surprised you're not happy she's dead. The words pierced her heart. Scarlett knew her attitude had sucked. Didn't Ashley know how horrible Scarlett felt? She wasn't a genie, though. She couldn't take it all back. And life with her mom was hard. The paranoia, The compulsion? The apathy? Of course she would judge Scarlett. Flawless Ashley, who never broke curfew, who never got a bad grade, who always wore a smile on her face no matter what kind of day their mom was having. She didn't worry that she'd inherited their mom's illness. Ashley was good without trying. An angel sent from the heavens. Scarlett might have been a devil, but at least she was one who desperately tried to grow wings. She just sucked at it. I know I messed up a lot. I'm trying to be better, Scarlett said. It's too late, Scarlett. Mom died. Scarlett clenched her teeth. The breath froze in her lungs. Ashley's words cut through flesh and dug into Scarlett's soul, a million needles twisting into her heart. She screwed up sometimes. Maybe it was her fault. It didn't matter anymore, though. Her mom was gone. Nothing could bring her back. Without another word, Scarlett stomped past Ashley and went straight to her mother's room, slamming the door behind her. The sweet smell of her mother's perfume still lingered. The blinds were closed, allowing only small cracks of the overcast light to enter. The large painting of an ocean sunrise Ashley had painted hung above the dresser, still filled with their mother's clothes. Neither sister had been able to go through the drawers yet. Scarlett crawled into bed and under the covers, like she did as a child. It had always been her safe place, from the boogeyman to a bad day at school, the one place she could go and everything would feel okay again. It wasn't the same without her mom there, but it still comforted her. She barely slept at night anymore. When she dozed off, nightmares tormented her until she woke screaming. Were they the first step in losing her mind? First nightmares, next voices? She wondered what her mom's first symptom was. Lack of sleep drained Scarlett, and right then, all she wanted to do was fall asleep and forget her life. The sun warmed Scarlett's face, seeping into her fair skin as her back pressed into the cold ground below. She peered into the perfectly blue sky and searched for shapes in the cumulus clouds, finding a sailboat and a cat missing an ear. Something was different. How did she get here? The last thing she remembered was falling asleep in her mother's bed. She must have been dreaming. Her mind relaxed as she waited in the middle of an open meadow. Red, blue, and yellow flowers were scattered amongst the tall green grass. Calmness had become a foreign feeling to Scarlett. She welcomed the serenity it held. A gentle breeze blew her dark locks. This wasn't real. It couldn't be. She'd never been to this meadow before, but it didn't feel fake either. It was unlike any dream she'd ever had.
Hello,
a voice said behind her. It didn't startle her. It was as if she'd expected it to come. With a tone warm like honey, she relaxed even more. Her weight sank into the earth as tranquility washed over her. Scarlett pushed her body to a sitting position and turned to see a young man nearing. He approached her with an extended hand. She'd read somewhere that everyone in her dreams was someone she'd seen before, but she was certain if she'd seen this face, she would remember. His eyes were aqua, and Scarlett felt lost in them as if they were as vast as the Caribbean Sea. She reached instinctively for his hand, which burned hotter than her own.
You're beautiful,
he said. He was beautiful, not her. The two sides of his face aligned in perfect symmetry, with ears pointed ever so slightly, Scarlett almost didn't notice. His skin was smooth as silk, but his aura burned hot. Scarlett's awe kept her silent. Who was he? He locked his fingers with hers. His piercing eyes stirred her stomach. Who are you? Scarlett asked. His mouth curved into a half smile.
Cade,
he said.
But more importantly, Who are you?
Scarlett. He leaned into her and inhaled the scent of her neck. Scarlett's eyes closed as her nerves prickled. She wanted to press her body into his. She needed to. Scarlett had never felt such desire before. Nearly unnatural desire. Cade wrapped his free hand around her and pulled her toward him. He was much taller than her, with broad shoulders and a strong build. Why was she acting like this? She didn't even know him. Sure, Scarlett had done her share of things with guys, but she'd never felt so out of control of herself. His mouth nibbled on the most sensitive part of her neck. A sigh escaped her lips. Her body fell further into his as her hands moved to his chest. Cade's mouth grew more aggressive until he groaned. The air around Scarlett cooled as Cade's touch left her.
Sorry, beautiful. Duty calls.
He let go of her hand and stepped backward.
Don't worry. I'll find you again.
After the words left his mouth, he disappeared. Scarlett jolted upright in her bed.
Of course you'd ruin my perfectly good dream,
Cade said as he pulled out of Scarlett's mind. Raith's voice had broken his connection to her. Scarlett, such a lovely human. Something about her called to Cade. To be so infatuated with a mortal wasn't something he'd admit to. But after only a few minutes of her in his dreamscape, magic blazed again through his veins. His training had grown brutal over the last 2 weeks. His mother insisted he intensely prepare himself for the upcoming battle against his brother. Cade didn't see Raith as much of a threat. As far as he knew, Raith didn't even train. But Raith was older, his mother constantly reminded him, and had had more time to learn his power.
To live in dreams is a waste of reality, dear brother,
Raith said.
Preying on the innocent little humans.
Raith's loose tan shirt was half untucked from his pants as if he'd just rolled out of bed. Sloppy, if you asked Cade. That and his unruly chin-length hair made him look more like a beggar than a prince.
Oh, please. I give them good dreams that they won't even remember.
Cade pushed himself from his bed.
What do you care? You don't even associate with them.
Raith shrugged.
The king wants to see us.
Cade followed him to the battle wing of the castle. Here, the new military recruits trained each spring. The summer court hadn't been attacked in years. They'd defeated the winter court a half century ago in a small war, but still, the threat of another attack kept young, sturdy summer fae signing up to keep the kingdom strong. Cade was too young to know anything but the history of the war. Now that summer had come, this part of the castle was empty except for Cade and Wraith's training. At the end of the summer, Cade would challenge Raith for the right of heir. As the oldest son of the king, Raith was granted the title until Cade, his only sibling, was of age. Any time after age 19, a younger sibling could battle against the current heir. Most waited years, as Fae power was unpredictable and harder to manage in early adulthood. But their father grew weaker every day, and Cade's mother urged him to challenge right away. The temperature of the battle wing was at least 10 degrees cooler than the other parts of the castle. Cold suppressed his power, but promoted magic alertness. If he ever faced someone outside of his own court, his power would be weakened. Cade walked a few feet behind Raith. The two had been close as children, playing in the fields, pranking the castle staff, sneaking into the forest they were forbidden from entering. As the two grew older, the distance between them swelled. Cade knew Raith was jealous of him. His own mother had died, and Raith never accepted Cade's mother as his own. Their father waited in the battle room in the training tower. His salt and pepper hair almost reached his shoulders now, a big change to the short hair he'd had when Cade was a child. He wore a gold crown decorated with emeralds atop his head. Wrinkles had formed on his face. Such a rare occurrence for a high fae. The walls of stone stood high in the large room.
Swords, staffs, and other weapons hung on the far wall. The king stood in the middle of the room. His hands clung to his sides, and his eyes remained closed.
"My sons," he said, his voice weak.
He turned to them and opened his eyes. The quick deterioration of the king was peculiar. Most High Fae lived for centuries. A benefit of the magic that coursed through their veins was good health. Something had caused the king's health to dwindle, but no one had been able to determine what. Cade suspected it had something to do with the Winter Court. Poison, perhaps. But it was nothing more than a guess. Cade rarely saw his father lately. Spring was a quiet season for the Summer Fae. The festivals and dances happened mostly in their respective season.
"Summer is here. Your battle will be the center of the summer festivities. Come closer."
He motioned toward them. Cade and Raith stepped closer. Both boys stood taller than their father, Cade the tallest of the three. Raith had steel blue eyes that matched their father's, while Cade had inherited his mother's. The king placed his hands on each son's shoulder.
"The battle is inevitable, I know. As an only child, I was fortunate enough not to fight for the right of heir. But I never had the blessing of a sibling, as you two do. I pray you remember that you will always be brothers."
The king had grown sentimental as his health decayed. Hoping for a brotherly relationship between Cade and Raith was wishful thinking, but Cade wouldn't be the one to ruin a dying man's dream.
"Of course,"
Raith said as he mimicked his father's gesture.
"The right of heir should go to the most capable. No hard feelings if my younger brother wins."
Raith patted the king's shoulder. He grinned at Cade, and Cade knew that Raith had as little faith as he did that they would ever be as close as they once were. The king took his hands back to his side.
"The festivities will start next week. You will both be obligated to attend each event. Each of you should spend most of your time training over the summer. You are each assigned a guide from my guard to help you prepare. Please restrain from any physical harm to one another in the meantime."
A twinkle flickered in his eye, reminding Cade of a younger version of his father, one he hadn't seen in a very long time.
"Certainly,"
Cade said. A coughing spasm attacked the king, who excused himself to his bedroom to rest. Cade saw Raith smirk as they left the battle room.
"Laugh now, but I will defeat you."
Raith patted his brother on the back.
"I expect you to try."
"My magic is stronger than ever," Cade said. Raith always underestimated him, patronizing Cade every chance he had. He would soon see that he'd been unwise to belittle his potential.
"I have secrets that even you don't know."
After another chuckle, Raith replied,
"So do I."
It had been a long time since they'd gotten along. So long, Cade had almost forgotten how it felt to have the brotherly love they once had. Or Cade had. He used to wonder if Raith ever loved him. But not anymore. All that mattered now was preparing for the battle. Cade's mother had spoken to him on his 19th birthday.
"You must challenge your brother. Your father is ill, and if something happens to him, I fear for our safety,"
she had said.
"You are strong and far more of a leader than Raith."
She spat out his name as if it were poison. His mother had little love for her stepson. As a child, Cade had tried to encourage the two to get along, but it hadn't worked. The more he tried, the more his mother disliked Raith. Eventually, he gave up. Cade remembered the determination in her eyes when she told him he must challenge Raith. Even if he wasn't ready, he would do it. He couldn't disappoint her. He must win.
Chapter 3. Raith watched his little brother hurry away, probably running to tell his mother about the meeting with the king. Cade was a mama's boy to the core. Raith had no mother. Not anymore. She'd died long ago, and Raith had learned to take care of himself. His father had been seduced by Cassandra, the new queen. From the moment she had greeted the king at the winter ball, he was in trouble. Cassandra was sweet to the eye, with long golden hair and icy blue-green eyes. But as Raith grew, he saw through her beauty. He sensed her greed, her pride, her jealousy. All the desires the king was blind to. Within a month of their marriage, Cassandra held Cade in her womb. Raith was only 5 when Cade was born, and for many years he was the perfect big brother. When he was allowed to be around Cade, that was. Cassandra watched Raith closely. He felt her stare on him constantly. Even as a child, Raith was perceptive. He felt himself pushed out of the family as Cassandra tightened her grip on the king. But when Raith turned 19, his father had bestowed the right of heir to him. Even though it was custom to grant the oldest child the right, it angered Cassandra, which brought joy to Raith's heart. Instead of going back to his room, Raith continued through the castle and out the back doors. The western sky faded from orange to purple to pink as the sun set behind the mountains in the distance. The back exit avoided the guards, who were nosy bastards that always wanted to know where he was going. At least once a day, Raith made his way to the forest. Years ago, he'd placed a gate on the castle border wall so he could come in and out as often as he pleased. Cassandra complained it compromised security, but Raith had magicked the gate so only summer royalty could unlock it, so the king said it could stay. Most Fae from the castle feared the darkness within the woods. The forest had a mind of its own, stronger the deeper into the forest one would go. And magic. It could make people see things that weren't there, feel things crawl on them, hear snarls and howls. Of course, it could only do these things if you let it. Raith never did. The forest was full of trickery, but Raith's magic kept it from breaking into his mind. As a summer court fae, Raith possessed mind powers. So did Cade, but they had different types of mind magic. Cade could enter dreams. He could use the emotion to refill his magic. Humans would wake up unaware that Cade had been there. Raith's magic was different. He had access to memories, to see memories of others, to erase them, to share his own. The emotion in them fueled him as dreams did Cade. Raith could also use real-life emotion, like all High Fae, the human-like Fae who were the most powerful. The feeling of someone's emotion coursing through him was incredible, a high like no other. But he had other means to refresh his magic. Nature. His mother had taught him how to use nature to gain energy shortly before she died. She'd made him promise not to let anyone know what he could do. It was their secret. And an autumn court ability, as far as Raith knew. He wasn't sure how he could do it, but whatever the reason, he was glad. When he and Cade would sneak into the forest to play, he could use his magic in front of Cade, but he never shared its source. He kept his promise to his mother and never told another soul. The castle courtyard was the only thing between the castle and the summer wood. Raith followed a stone path, past a fountain of carved roses, and then walked across grass until he reached a gate in the fence at the edge of the forest. When his hand touched the gate's iron handle, it clicked open. As he stepped into the cover of the trees, his senses sharpened. His eyes adjusted to the darkness. He inhaled the crisp forest scent as he pressed further until he came to a tall tree that curved like a quarter moon. Its trunk was thick and rose high. At first glance, it looked like any of the other trees around. Bigger, perhaps, but just as tree-like.
but a door was hidden in the moss-covered bark. Raith swung the door open with his magic. Inside, a ladder led down. He lit a candle at the top, shut the door, and climbed downward to a large room below the ground. More candles illuminated the room. On the far wall, a green blanket covered the bed. Close to the ladder, an oversized chair and ottoman sat, both charcoal in color. Raith walked across the wooden floor and over a braided rug. He closed his eyes and breathed deeply, and a fire grew in the fireplace, sending warmth throughout the room. This place was his and his alone. He'd never brought anyone here. Not Cade, not any of the female Fae he'd taken home to bed. On those nights, he went to his room in the castle, which was more impressive to them anyway. When Raith needed time alone, he came to this tree. Its coziness clothed him like a blanket. Here, he could think about anything without interruption. About his mother, about the upcoming battle. He popped open a bottle of Fae wine and poured a glass. As he sipped the berry-flavored beverage, a tingle ran through him. Raith sprawled out on the bed, leaning against the willow tree headboard. Cade thought he would defeat Raith. He assumed that Raith didn't practice his magic enough. Maybe he thought Raith didn't have much magic. But Cade would soon learn just what Raith was capable of. Scarlett found herself at the top of the hill again. Unlike yesterday, today the sun shined brightly. High in the sky, its rays heated Scarlett's skin. Today was the first day she made the trip alone. She hadn't spoken to Ashley since their fight. Ashley had locked herself in her room and had only come out to heat up a frozen dinner in the microwave. More than ever, Scarlett wanted to go to her mom's grave. Nope. As usual, her fear overpowered everything. What a lousy chicken. She hated it. It was weak, the complete opposite of what her mother and life had taught her to be. As a child, she was brave. She didn't know what she was anymore. Pathetic. That was it. She was pathetic. It was a lousy thing to be. But she didn't know how not to be. The thought of facing her mother's grave made every ounce of logic inside her vanish. Her chest would tighten, and a wave of nausea would wash over her. Every day it was the same thing, over and over. Maybe she should quit trying. Nothing had changed, no matter how many times she'd gone to the edge of the hill. She always froze. But despite her failures, she was stubborn. If she was too chicken to face her mother, she deserved to feel miserable until she could. Since Ashley wasn't there, Scarlett didn't have to wait for anyone. She could just turn around and go back home. But nothing waited for her there, so she sat on the edge of the hill and viewed her mother's grave from afar. No one else was around. Birds chirped a melodious song, a private concert just for Scarlett. Her thoughts drifted to the dream she'd had. It had played over in her head all morning. She couldn't shake the feeling that it was something more than just a dream. She couldn't say why she felt this way, which was anything but reassuring. It made sense that her brain had played out a fantasy in her sleep. She hadn't even thought about guys since she found her mom. Soon after her mother's death, she quit dating and going to parties, even texting. The only person she talked to outside of school was her best friend, Natalie. Maybe her body was having guy withdrawals. But the dream felt too real to be some subconscious message. Her mother had always sworn her hallucinations were real. Scarlett shoved the thought away, shifting her musings back to the dream. Her body tingled when she thought of Cade's mouth on her neck. No matter what kind of boy mess she'd ever gotten herself into, she could always go to her mom for advice. How Scarlett missed her. There had never been anything they couldn't talk about, even something as bizarre as Scarlett's dream. Her mom would tell her not to worry. Dreams were just escapes from reality. She'd laugh and add that she'd had some crazy dreams herself, yet was completely convinced that the voices she heard were real. The ache crept back into Scarlett's heart. The birds went silent. Something crunched behind her. She twisted her body around. What she saw shocked her. Cade. The man who seduced her in the most peculiar dream of her life stood there, seemingly in the flesh, dressed in clothing from a different time period. Could she be dreaming again? She didn't think so. Was she hallucinating?
I feel your sadness,
Cade said.
I know you don't know me, but I can help.
His large eyes stared at her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.